Come on. It's time.
Say she needs somebody.
Somebody that's gonna treat me right.
Uh-oh.
She needs somebody.
Uh-oh. It's time, y'all. Woo! This song called Grown Man.
I need a grown
man. Uh-oh.
Somebody that's gonna treat me.
How y'all doing?
Somebody
that's gonna love me. How you doing, Mr. Lewis? Happy birthday. Your wife is loving all on you. That's so beautiful. Yes.
I can count my own.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing feels wrong.
Come on. We're going to talk about living. That's right.
I want to get on to my knees when you call
my name.
Can you work my body?
I'm putting my email up here.
Whenever I call.
No excuses. No excuses.
That's the kind of man.
That's right.
I need in my life.
How you doing, Mr. H-O-A? Maurice Jefferson. Oh. Yes, indeed. It is time, y'all. It is time. For us to get going. What a beautiful day. Can't even complain. You can't complain about pollen on a beautiful day like today. It is beautiful. We're just blessed. We are truly blessed. We're just blessed. Yes, indeed. I don't know if it was beautiful down in Stone Mountain, Georgia. But it was. Look at that. Weed had a birthday, too. She had a great birthday. I saw all those pictures everywhere. She posted those pictures, Reverend Bozeman. It's about living. But we're going to talk about life insurance because there are so many scams using life insurance that, you know, out here that, you know, Miss Moore, I just said, we got to talk about life insurance. You know, how you doing? 77793. That's right. But, you know, I don't know if any of you, and when I said Q&A, you know, when I sent out the invitation, so if any of you don't get the invitation, make sure you go to the website behind and register or take advantage of the complimentary membership so that you get all of the invitations and then you can graduate and get the real membership. No, thank you, Ms. Moore. Yeah, I want to talk about because, you know, clients send me these questions about different stuff that comes through with that, like that TikTok stuff and all these people like doing those little commercials, acting like that, you know, they have this great ingenious idea nobody ever thought about before. And, you know, I think that they don't know the history behind people getting sued for selling life insurance incorrectly. No. And, you know, so a lot of people will do things and make money off you. And, you know, by the time you figure it out, you've wasted thousands of dollars. You know, yes, yes. You want to encourage them to purchase life insurance for himself and his two children. You know, sound like the, I want us to really, you know, talk about that. No, because a lot of people get caught up in spending too much and getting underprotected. You know, if somebody has two children that they have to provide for, the children don't need the life insurance. Who needs the life insurance? No? Who needs the life insurance?
You know? The parent is the one that needs it.
Yeah, the parent is the one who the family will be at a loss. Assume, you know, even if the parent is a stay-at-home worker, they take the children to school, they do the tutoring after school and things like that. Like, that person is a valuable asset to the family. And they're not a caretaker. They kind of call that for people that take care of other people, but people that take care of their children, you know, they're just a stay-at-home parent that's raising the child, you know, and both parents, even if you don't stay at home, you're a caretaker for your children. We really, should feel that way. But the person who stays, if a person chooses to not work outside of the home, it's the Reverend Bozeman, hit your microphone, see if it'll, if anything will change. Okay. I mean, if it doesn't mute. They definitely are spending a lot. They did a survey the other day. And yeah, I don't know why it makes that noise like in a horror movie. You know what I mean? Like when the creatures are coming to get you, when the mic is open. Yeah, 7793 7793 11. Oh, 7793 is that? Oh man. Hooked on phonics. That's right. I'm 52 and I think I paid too much and was underprotected. Well, 52 is young. And if you couldn't have been underprotected because you're still alive. But if something drastic had happened, you know, yeah, you would have been underprotected, I guess. But it's only relevant if you needed that in the past. And like, say your kids are grown now and they take care of themselves. Well, that time period that you were underprotected, by the grace of God, you lived through it. The father, yeah, over the children, but not the father over the mother. Yeah. The parents, we should say, because somebody will say, she said the father. You know what I'm saying? Like, she would say the father. But, like, I even believe that, if a person is paying child support, then the other parent really doesn't have to get life insurance on the other parent because what? Like, if they're not together. And yeah, that would be the only reason they would have the child support thing. You know, it's because if they have a document that says, like, you know, that they're paying, that means that they are proven to be paternity, you know, or have legally accepted paternity for the child. So if they die while the children are still in need of child support, the good news is if that parent, you know, actually is working, you know, then the children will still get a check for that parent through their Social Security. But, you know, so it's not like a big problem. The bigger problem from an insurance perspective, and people don't talk to us about this, is disability. No, because like, where you were saying, like, underprotected, like a young person is more likely to become disabled than to die, than to be killed. But we're more likely to be, you know, solicited for, life insurance. And I think it's just because from a basis of being motivated about making money off our community. Because if they were strictly need-based, you know, which, you know, we do in the Afroeconomics, you know, and we're talking about budgeting, you know, there's a lot of different things that would be done that I see in our community all the time with life insurance. Like, we're more likely to have, like, say the parents have $100,000 on each other, and they're paying $100 a month for that, permanent insurance because the person that sold it to them, telling them how much money they're going to have down the road in their cash value at the age of, you know, whatever, 65. But they don't tell them that that's not guaranteed. They present it to them as if it's guaranteed and that this life insurance is going to be your savings account. And it's going to be extra money for you, you know, if you live. Meanwhile, as 7779311 said, you're underprotected. You got three kids with $100,000 on each other apiece. What are you going to do with that? What in the world can you do to help three kids if you die unexpectedly while they're still in that house and you still have that mortgage or have that rent that you were paying all of or most of or half of? Your income is going to be lost. You're underprotected and you're spending too much money. And I see it over and over and over, and it's, you know, and I'll show them like, okay, you should have this policy and it will give you five times that coverage. And it will also pay out if you have, you know, a critical illness or if you have a chronic illness, and it'll have, all of this for less than the premium they're paying for that permanent policy because that person got to them first and they don't even want to try to figure out the analysis of it that, you know, you got robbed and you're wasting your money. So you don't like, you know, I can't say straight wasting your money, but that's just not enough. You know, we can sit down and just, you know, theorize, you know, you're making $50,000 a year and you're paying for half the bills in the house, you know, say like one rule of thumb that you could say is said that, you know, have at least 10 times your salary. Or if you have enough in the life insurance to actually pay your salary, you need to have $1 million policy to replace $50,000 a year in income. Yeah. But if you're trying to do $1 million policy and the person is focused on maximum commission to them, then you're not going to be able to afford it. Most people with three kids and young couple and this and that, it's not going to be able to afford it. So you don't even bother to ask or get any other quotes from anybody else. You know, this is a scenario that goes on and on in our community. Then the person unfortunately dies and then we have another broke family out there for no reason. And it's over and over and over and over because you're only talking to insurance agents when you should be talking to a financial advisor that happens to also be licensed in insurance. That's what I do. So my clients don't have to depend totally on life insurance. It's not the only thing that I do. But when you're talking to someone and that's the only thing that they're going to do, I remember being at an event one time and these guys sold life insurance and it said life, it had like 20,000 different things that life insurance, you know, was going to answer for. It was like, use it for college, use it for retirement, use it for, you know, income, use it for a loan, use it for business, use it for, you know, I mean, at what point does it run out? And the point of it is, it's supposed to be for the death benefit. Do you know how many years guaranteed it would take for you to accumulate that money to take care of all those needs by using that life insurance and what your premium would have to be so that you were paying so much extra that it was going in to their cash value? Your payment would be huge. And it is a very costly way to save. You know, and you know, life insurance itself, like, tried to become all things to all people. So then when the agents came out, they start trying to be all things to all people. And then the lawsuits started when the people found out there wasn't all things to all people. I'm yes, Ms. Davis.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Could I go out and purchase, I just want to go out and purchase a $10 million policy, but my salary and the money I make doesn't justify my being able to pay for that type premium? It true or false? Is there a limit to the amount of insurance I could purchase, life insurance? Yes. I could purchase based upon my salary?
Yes. It has to be a proven need and a proven insurable interest. You know, like, I couldn't just go out and get a $10 million policy on you because of your $10 million personality, you know, because I don't have insurable interest in you. But mm-hmm. if me and you started a business together worth, you know, $20 million, I could get a $10 million policy on you.
All right, but could I go and initiate a $10 million policy on myself and make, you know, the beneficiary, whoever I make the beneficiary as, can I, but my salary doesn't justify.
Well, see, you just can't, yeah, it's not going to go through underwriting because they're going to think you're going to try to kill yourself. You know what I mean? Or something like, yeah. And you also, like, you could be using it to try to create some sort of tax shelter. So there's a maximum amount that you can put in, you know what I mean, for that the IRS will allow to be put into, you know, the policy over a certain time period. So what, like, your $10 million might, you know, come about because, like, you inherited $100,000 and you wanted to try to hide it from taxes or something like that. And you wanted, you know, to run it, and you ran into this agent and he said, yeah. Put it in this policy, you know, and, you know, their commission is going to be great, but it might get into underwriting. They'll go, what she need all that for? Like, what's going on?
All right.
And
so
if there's lies in there, they're not going to pay it out. They'll just give your beneficiaries the money back. Like, you make up a story about why you need it and this and that. You know, if you die and that's not provable, you know, they will not pay it out. They'll just return the premium.
All right. Okay. So let's say instead of 10 million, let's say I'm allowed to do 5 million based upon my salary. Mm-hmm. Policy on myself.
And assets or other loans or whatever that you have. You know what I'm saying? That it will show, like, you know, or you have 5 kids or, you know, something.
All right. 10, so I'll get past underwriting kids with, let's say, Metropolitan Life. Then can I go and not tell Metropolitan Life, but go over to Liberty Life and do the same thing?
You probably used to be able to, but now they all talk to each other, just like with your car. You know, they all talk to each other and they ask you on the application, do you have any existing, you know what I mean, policies? So one of them you had to have lied on, you know, to tell the other, because then the other would have to prove that you needed, you know, both. But I feel that in some cases, it's better to, in many cases, it's better to keep the old policy and buy additional policy than to get rid of the old policy to get additional coverage that you actually need. Like, you know, you might have had $100,000 need, but now you're, you know, you have a baby on the way, you know, so you need more. You don't have to get rid of that 100,000 policy because many policies have waiting periods, you know. So if you get rid of that old policy and then you get the new policy and then you die in a couple of months, the new policy may have a 2-year waiting period. Right, Kanika, you know. So if it has a 2-year waiting period and you got rid of your old policy, you're going to get nothing. Your beneficiaries will get nothing but return a premium, whatever you had paid in that far.
And then they might not get the whole return of premium, right? There's probably going to be some fees or something taken.
Yeah, I have a policy fee, or, you know, yeah, exactly. So, you know, the, you know, you would have to, you know, find out. And that's why also, if you're replacing, insurance does a good job of asking, is this replacing any other policy? You know, and then, but I have seen, you know, clients come to me with policies from other agents who have told them that they are going to have a particular amount of money if you pay this amount in at a particular time, and make an outside plan. On the policy, it says, have you been given any information that is not from this company? And I saw on that client's policy, it said no. But he had been given an entire financial plan that was saying, talking about what that policy was going to do, and was not in that policy information. It did not. It was not guaranteed to do none of what it had in that financial plan. So a lot of people don't know how to, you know, read, you know, the quote. Read, like, one client asked me to look at a quote that I gave her a quote, and then this other person gave her a quote. And the new quote was for less coverage, and they were charging her more, you know, in the premium. And the premium that they gave her was not guaranteed, you know, to last. And for the 20 year, I was telling her to do a 20 or 30 year term. So if she did a 30 year term, she would have more coverage than that other policy already. And that other policy was going to go up, you know, within that 30 year time period. Now, term isn't appropriate for everybody, but if a person has a particular need that has to be covered, and I'm not going to have that need after 20 years, like my house only, the house, you know, may only have 20 years left on the mortgage, or the kids will be grown, you know, after 20 years, because they're already 10. They'll be 30 years old in 20 years. I don't need, you know what I mean? They don't have to have a permanent policy if getting the proper coverage is not affordable. What we should be focused on is first determining how much is needed. Not some quote that, you know, someone in the business is giving you, you know, that's just what they want to make off you. The effort needs to be in, what do you need? And I've been in a few. I've been in one session on a panel, and no, I prefer not to be on panels with other people in the business. Y'all know why? Y'all know why?
Probably because you're going to challenge them over what's really the shadiness that they're probably trying to spew or spout, knowing you.
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
All of us got bills to pay. All of us got bills to pay.
But right, I'm just saying,
I know exactly, because I'm going straight to the truth.
Yeah, that's probably why.
I don't know what they do, but I want them to make money. I want everybody to make money. But the key is to build up our community. Because if we don't do right by our community, then the next generation suffers. And then the next generation suffers. And then the next generation suffers. So the reason that we don't do what we're supposed to do in many situations is because of the harm that has been done to us by people in that situation. So it's not going to change. Like, you know, when people go to a bad doctor, then they never want to go back to the doctor again. No, they go to school. The school says, you're never going to be nothing. They don't switch schools. They drop out of school. So when you go and you, like, I had an uncle, he bought some stock. It was stupid stock. It was a straight stupid stock. But he blamed the whole stock market, you know what I mean, on that stupid investment that he made when he was a bus driver. Somebody came on the bus telling him, you know what I'm saying? Come on, Unc, you got to consider where you are. Like, what, you know what? They were just telling you something. Like, you don't, you can't be afraid, but people do what? They get afraid of the whole thing. So when people, no, like my client, when he discovered that he was being lied to by that insurance agent, you know, he was ready to flip the entire table over. And rightfully so. Like, it's, you know, and when we try to fight it and even get regulators to help him, nobody wanted to help him get his money back. So a license is not going to help you get your money back. You know, you think, oh, okay, because that person's got that license, that means no, because that company wants them to go out there and get that deal. And if they're lying to you, you know, that company, you pay it, you know, for long enough, and they ain't got to give you your money back, and you went past the waiting period, and this and this and that, they're not. I was shocked. The client had a copy of every lie that the person told him, and they still did not make them give that money back. False presentation, everything. I was impressed that he had all the stuff. He said, oh yeah, I got everything. Everything. It blew my mind. I was like, I can't believe he lied like this. So I called and I said, you know, bro, like it was a brother. I said, you know, why'd you do this? Why did you do this to him? He says, so you don't think that I'm supposed to make money? I said, but you got to hurt this brother to make money? I know this sister, the member, she said, oh, I went to, I think it was like State Farm or Nationwide, one of them. I went in there because, they sell a lot of life insurance. So she said she went, and when you get doing your car insurance or whatever they do, you know, they start talking to you about, I guess, the life insurance. So she had life insurance. So she said, I had to update the beneficiary, and he told me I had to sign forms, and I signed these forms, and, you know, I got a whole new policy. And I said, what do you mean? She said, well, I got a whole new policy. That man, when she got the first policy, she wasn't a smoker. He put her on a new policy. All she was coming in was to update beneficiary stuff. Got her in a whole new policy with a higher, with the premium about the same, but it was higher. And because of her now being a smoker, their health condition, her premium amount, was, you know, the part of her money every month was going into the premium, not into the cash value. And I could explain it to her because I could see the numbers. And I said, so, for example, your $125 you were doing a month before, $70 of that was going to your cash value, for example. I said, now that he's switched you, he's made you a smoker, you know what I mean? And now, this new policy has about $20 of your money going into cash value. She said, oh, I can't believe it. Oh, that's terrible. And still stayed. Still stayed. So, you know, you have to, you know, be very, very careful what you're doing. I mean, the, life insurance is one of the most substantial contracts in the world. Like I was telling y'all in one of our member meetings that I didn't realize that on my own, I got like a rather large policy in my 20s because I had already started my business in my 20s. And then, so I thought that if I put extra money in it, it would pay extra, you know, to my beneficiary. And they said, no, no, no. Now here I am, I'm the agent. They said, no, it doesn't matter, you know, how much extra, you know, you put in. Like, this is the max death benefit, period. So the, you know, I think that, you know, we, I don't know, I guess, you know, at that age, I hadn't gone through enough of what you all go through for me to not trust anything. Now at this point, like my, you know, you all can depend on me as your advisor. See, I'm licensed in it, but the bottom line, I'm a registered investment advisor. Everything I do has to be in your best interest. Where just a basic life insurance agent, they only have to make sure it's suitable for you. Like what Ms. Davis was saying, that you have a reason, a purpose for it that's just suitable. Doesn't mean it's in your best interest. To cancel the other and get this. But we don't want that money going over there. I want that money and I want this new money too. So let's get this. That's what we have to be careful. You can't move. And then I see people like doing fast moves all their life, get with me, and all of a sudden, you know, and especially the women, guys, and you know, seem to me have a better judge of character. Like, if this woman is giving me more coverage and it costs less, I'm gonna get the shit. It's just plain as simple. But I'm just gonna say they have a better judge of character. I do the same thing with us ladies. And they'll say, I just don't know what to do. Oh my. We should never, ever, 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 ever wonder why we broke. Nobody's broke by accident. I meet a broke person, give me 10 minutes with them. 10 minutes. I know. Don't even know who to be suspicious of. Somebody come, dress nice. You're doing anything with them. Don't let them take you out to cheap Chinese. Oh my God. It's just sad. The word says a fool and his money shall soon part. That's why it doesn't matter how many degrees that we get if we're not going to use our wisdom and looking at things clearly. That is clearly, you don't have to go to college to do that. To figure that out, $200,050 a month, you know, or $100,000 at $60 a month. I don't understand where the trick could be. Let's just say they're both permanent policies. Both. We're not even comparing apples to oranges because, you know, you might, somebody out there is saying, but one is term and one is, no, both permanent. I love permanent policies, especially with young people. Get a good permanent policy. I remember the first time I put somebody in a variable insurance policy and they said all their friends were like, man, but what if the premium goes up? What if the premium goes up and this and that? They've had that policy. The husband and wife, I went to college with them and they gave me 30 years. The premium has never adjusted.
Now, when you say
and permanent, I told them.
Wait, are you talking whole life when you say that?
No, there's two types of policies, term or permanent. Now, when they start saying whole life, universal, and all that, that's just different types of permanent coverage. That's all, they're all permanent. Universal, whole life, you know, it's just different terms on how your cash value is accumulated. It's all in the numbers. you know, what, how your fees will be adjusted, what are guarantees, and the, you know, but it's term or permanent. Mm-hmm. And which term? You got a whole bunch of different types of term now. Now, will say permanent, but they're really term policies.
That right. So if a policy is whole life or universal life, it is a permanent policy.
Whole life or universal, all those are permanent. Yeah.
Permanent. Okay. Yeah. And then term is just term.
For a particular period of time. That's right.
Convertible term, whatever. It's all these different terms, but it terms.
But some companies try to use a convertible term and say it's a permanent policy. And it's not. It's term. And you only way that for that to really work for you is for you to know, like some people do like a 1 year convertible term and every year the damn thing's going up, 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 up. How you budget with that? This year, your policy caused this. This year, your policy caused that. You know what I'm saying? If you know I have this particular need for a particular period of time, don't let them talk to you into something that you really, unless you know for sure your income's going up every year. But if anything, you're going to have other expenses. How you do a financial plan on something that they decide how they're going to let it go up? There are permanent policies. Kanika was asking, are there whole life policies that can expire at a certain age? There are permanent policies of every kind that will adjust at a certain age. Unless you do it at the beginning and say, I want this paid up at the age of 80. You know what I mean? Or paid up at 90. But like, say you do it, you get it, and you say, this is going to be paid up to the age of 80. And the person gets to like 60 years old, and then they take out money from their cash value. What happens, Reverend Bozeman? It opened and then it closed back. They took the loan out. They took the loan out, but it opened, but then it closed back. I heard your mic open, but then it closed back out. Were you saying something?
Yeah, I was saying that they lose, the money is deducted from their face value.
So all of a sudden they get to 80 and their premium has gone up. And like Kanika is saying, I know she's probably seen family members and they go, my life insurance is going to go down in coverage, or I have to increase what I'm paying, you know?
Right.
So what has happened is they can't remember that loan they didn't pay back in their 50s or 60s or 70s. You know what I'm saying? They didn't ask. They didn't talk to J.B. Bryan about it. They don't know. You know what I mean? That what they're doing is affecting them, even though they sell it to you like it's going to pay off at 80. And then they come back in the next sentence, look at how much money you're going to have at 65. It kind of contradicts each other. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because if you do this cash value and you take some of that and don't give it back, that changes the entire scenario.
Okay.
And they're saying it's paid off at 80. You know what I mean? And a lot of times that's not even guaranteed. That's based on a column based on interest rates that might not even do what it illustrated.
All right. So you borrow... You have cash value that's built up, and then somebody borrows the money from the cash value.
You did it. You did it from yourself. Yeah.
Okay.
You
needed money. Now, I'm under obligation to pay that back. Surely I'm going to pay extra. If I get $3,000, I'm surely going to pay $3,000, maybe $300 in order to catch back up, whatever. Now,
you don't have to. That's something you would do. I've seen people obsess about that. You know what I'm saying? If you had the money, you wouldn't have taken it out in the first place.
Well, true.
So they're not going to give it back. So they need to really wake up on the fact that if you use this money, just like if you take your loan from your house and they say, don't worry, you ain't got to pay it. I'll put it on the end. You're going to regret it. But if you can't make the payment and you don't want to move, that's what you got to do. So you're taking it out and it's changing everything. Yes, it's changing everything. And we have to start realizing and accepting that reality, because I know that we know it, but we want to be in denial and think that you can have your cake and eat it too, and you cannot. So when they come in and lie to you and you know it sounds too good to be true, don't fall for it. Anything that sounds too good to be true is. No, and I go through that a lot. Like, you know, it'll be like, well, I want this. You know, well, if you want that, then, hey, you're going to have to, you know, only do so-and-so and so, because you know, huh, who am I, right? The one that's going to tell you the worst case scenario. Because I'm thinking I'm going to be with you for life. Now, but if you're calling an 800 number, they're not thinking about, I got to make sure Miss Jones is happy 30 years later. Me and Miss Jones, she's been my client since I was in my 20s. Now, here I am 30. Goodness gracious. You know, but I knew it then that we had to be in it. I had to be honest with her about what is what. This is the worst. This is what can happen. This is the worst thing that happened. You know, but a lot of people who are unfortunately selling life insurance, they're not staying in that business, or they just doing that part time. If you're dealing with a part time financial advisor, who are you going to call when something goes wrong?
All right. This is a situation I had. So my mom was in Alzheimer's. She had a universal life policy, and it was somewhere to the tune, I think, of $80,000. Unknown to me, my brothers probably sat her down at the phone, called the insurance company, borrowed $3,000 from the policy to do drugs with. See, this is where, you know, yeah. So we've had this kind of shit go on in my family.
And everybody, at some capacity on some shit, something, you know what I mean? On some level, like, you know, it's just a whole, goodness. Yeah.
I knew she had the policy, but I didn't know until after her death that that had happened. And it was $3,000 that had gotten taken from the cash value of it, you know, and it just, I was,
really mad. You were just really mad.
Pissed me off, you know.
Well, thank God she still could pay the premium. But it, like, but
wait a minute, hold up. You know who was paying the premium?
Oh, you were paying. Oh, so that's why you really felt ownership of it. Like, you're like, how y'all gonna do this behind my back?
You know, I was pretty doggone hot with him.
But if I had known you before your mother passed and you were doing that, I would have asked you to become owner on the policy. You know what I'm saying? So that things like that couldn't happen, especially when you're paying it. You could own, like, she could have designated you as the owner. So you would be the only person that could, you know, change the beneficiary and, you know, everything. So, like, you know, some people, like, get policies. Like, say, I was talking about, they call that key person or key man insurance. Like, I would own the policy on you and you would own the policy on me, you know, but it's on my life, and it's on your life, but... So that I can make sure that I stay as the beneficiary. You know, if not, you don't know, like you said, what the person is doing with your money.
He outsmarted me and outslicked me. And I just didn't know until, you know, we got into the end and at her death.
All you had to do was take it back, take it from the death benefit. Well, you got that $3,000 ahead of time. You know what I'm saying? You're not getting this.
Oh, well, it's sitting over in bank.
Yeah, so. But you're saving it for him. Like, but it's like that $3,000 shouldn't have gone over there. That $3,000 should have gone with you. Yeah. You know, like, and then since y'all want to do that. But the, but after that, like, he probably doesn't even remember. You know what I'm saying? People don't even remember. I don't know. It's just probably, you know, just something mental, I guess. You try to forget any, you know, crazy things you do. And they definitely didn't feel like they were doing any harm to you, you know.
Oh, no.
Mm-mm. Exactly. So they're like, we don't want to ask her for nothing, mama. So mama looking, you know, your mom said, you know what? I think I got something in that life insurance over there.
I don't think she even really at that point knew if she had now knowing her as I know her, mm-hmm. Oh, heck no. She would have never stood for that. She would never have done that. She never would have allowed that.
So that's even worse.
So he slipped her.
You feel like she didn't even know what was going on.
She didn't know what was going on. She never would have allowed that to happen.
But you know, like in the last days and when people think you know, are near the end, you know, they'll do pretty much whatever that person that's in their face will do. Because, you know, there's some things that my sister got my mother to do that I never would have thought my mother would have done, you know? And so, like, at the end, I have seen people change, you know, everything. Like, you know, everything. Like, so we have to be, you're right, like, you know, that it's just, and there's no protection on that. No. In addition to, you know, if you give a person power of attorney, they can change the beneficiary in your life insurance policy quickly. Investments too.
And see, I would have done that had I known that. And I just didn't know it until it was after her death.
Oh, you had power of attorney.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and you know, but a lot of things make more sense to you once you get to the other side of it. Like, you know, things that were happening, you know, at the end with my mom and the way that I was being pushed away from her. And, you know, my brother would even like, you can't talk to her. You can't talk. Don't talk to her about money, you know, and stuff like that. If my mother wanted advice, she couldn't even come to me and get it. Like, so it's, you know, It's really, you know, money and finances and, you know, life insurance. Like, you see that, you know, y'all know I used to. I'm doing better. I don't watch those crime shows like I used to. But a lot of it was over, like, life insurance policies. You know? I don't even know. You know, my mother probably had one, but I don't even know about it, like, you know, at all. Because she was given explicit instructions not to talk to me about anything financial. So the you know, there are a lot of things that can be done at the end, you know, and the, you know, people, they just want to keep peace. They just want to keep peace. Mm-hmm. Sad. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, we do stuff. We do stuff to ourselves, like Kanika was saying. Yeah, so they did reduce the death benefit by the amount of the loan. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a lot of people don't understand that, you know, that because that's the amount that they allowed her to take out. That was her cash value. So my thing is, like, how do you reduce the death benefit by the cash value in which you have actually paid more, too much money, like cash, but that is in a lot of policies. That is indeed in a lot of policies. Yes, they don't seek peace. They're just seeking their way. But we find peace. You know, I totally had to find peace in that I knew that after my father passed, that my entire life was going to be different. I just knew it. My dad was our rational person. And, you know, once he was gone, everything would be different. You know, it would be different. So I had to I did a lot of studying on detachment, you know, and not being attached, you know, to things. And I think that a lot of us, you know, could really find peace through doing that. Like, don't, you know, do what we do, you know, and I show love you know, to my mother for every day of her life, even our last time we were together. You know, I was wiping her butt in the hospital and everything, telling the nurses, no, I got it. I want this. I want to wipe my own mom's ass. I want to wipe my mother's ass. You know, it was like, I wanted my relationship with God is the only thing I wanted to be attached to. And I wanted to be humble enough, you know what I mean, to know that by his grace, I was here and I'm here. Amen. That we're here. But that is the only thing that we should get attached to. Like if you meet, like sometimes people meet people and, you know, they feel that I have to do this because, you know, that's the same person that my parents bought this from. And I have to always, and it's always been there, like, you know, and, you know, we can't do that. Like, you know, we have to, you know that it's, you know, don't get attached to, you know, to the concept, but get attached to truth. And if the truth is that you've got to make some changes for life to be better, then that's what we got to do. That's what we got to do. Don't go and this is the way things always were and this is the way that, you know, always be. No, that is not true. You know, everything is to evolve. We are supposed to use all of our knowledge, like in tonight's discussion, if it motivates somebody to, like, I have to, you know, get a better understanding of what I have. Like, you know, when someone, you know, joins, like, my first move is not like, okay, what we're going to sell? What are you going to buy from me? You know, my first move is to find out what exactly you're doing. What's going on? How is your tax situation? You know, how is your life? Is your, like, I have especially for young people, it's really good. The Money Guide, financial planning software is, you know, extremely valuable, and it's free with membership. And it just asks you everything, like, what are you afraid of? Where your goals are, when do you want to retire, you know, and it allows how much life insurance you have, what type it is. But you have to be willing to invest that amount of time into yourself. No, it is. I had to learn to detach from, I want this for you, so I'm going to force you into it. I had to learn to attach to those who need my help, who want my help, most importantly. Because sometimes we're like ignoring the you got all this food, you're trying to feed the homeless or whatever, you're trying to take care of a particular need, and you're going to go and walk right past everybody on your block, you know, because you want to make sure that you're doing it up there at the street where everybody else is doing it. No, it's like, no, help those right there in your face. That's what God told me. And that's why I feel like this discussion was really important, because my empowering you and giving you knowledge giving you things to look for is great for people like me who are looking out for the customer. It hurts and irritates the person who focuses on making sure we have a lack of knowledge. There's a lot of money that's made on our fear and lack of knowledge. And it's time for us to wake up and stop signing up for every multi-level marketing thing that there is, and stop believing that they know something that nobody else in the world knows. No, there is no hidden secret from us other than now, which we just will go out here and get it. Just, you can sit there and watch my videos and like get a college degree. Like, it just wouldn't get it, but you would have more information than a person who graduates with finance. And when it comes to personal finance, because when we study finance in school, it's on a corporate level. It has absolutely nothing to do with you. And a lot of people don't know that. They go, oh, you majored in finance. Like, you know, oh, you majored in accounting. That don't have anything to do with tax strategies. All of that is planning and preparing people to work in corporate America. Isn't that something? Most people just like don't know that. Yes, Ms. Jones said, I have group through former employer and another final suit policy. More than enough. Exactly. If I'm the beneficiary, that's not enough. Let's get some more. Let's triple that. 4 or 5 times. Yes, it is. And who decides how much you need, right? You decide. Because you can take care of final expenses with your checking account if you wanted to. Right? You don't even, you know, need it. Like, I was on a panel and this person that just focuses on life insurance, he said, I feel that everybody needs to have at least $1 million of life insurance, you know? And, you know, I don't know if I'm going to tell a client that has multiple millions with me already that they should have $1 million of life insurance. I just looked at them. I didn't say anything. You know what I'm saying? But people get off on that. Like, you know, that you got it. Like any rule, like y'all just gravitate, like just grab on to like any rule. No. So somebody out there is feeling like a loser because they may not have $1 million of life insurance on themselves. But they don't, you know, they don't need it possibly, or they don't want it. How in the world, like what type of company tells you what everybody's supposed to have? Like only life insurance can get away with something like that. You don't even hear disability policies say that. Like everybody need to have a disability policy, you know? It's like, first of all, we have to assess needs. No, but because $1 million for some people might not be nowhere near enough. Like there are some people who, when they retire, they don't do their joint pension. Like say that one of the spouses has a pension and the other person doesn't have a pension. So when that spouse with the pension retires, they said, well, I'll get a bigger check if I just, you know, take it on my life and I don't need to take, you know, do the joint where it'll pay you half if something happens to me. So I'll do this bigger one, right? So they get this policy and they're grown and the difference in the check is, you know, say like $150 that they're getting. But they go out there and they buy a policy on you that on themselves that costs $400 a month. Because they got to get something new, because it got to be something additional. It can't be what you already have, like, you know, but somebody might fall for that. But if you're going to go and like, I've spent my life with you and all of a sudden you're saying that your pension should only. Now, I can understand if they just got married or something like that, then the other person hopefully has their stuff together. They're not dependent on getting half of their check. But you've spent your life together. and your pension check is, say, $3,000. When you pass, that $3,000 is totally gone. I'm not even going to get $1,500. So basically, you should try to replace, you know, that $3,000 that, and that's after taxes. So say they're making about $4,000. So it's a $50,000, you know, so they have to get $1 million policy. They're grown. So they say they're in their 60s and they got a couple illnesses, you know, the premium is going to be high. Higher than the income that they just could have given up, you know, and let you get half of it down the road, which is still a setback. Like, some people retire and go into debt, more debt than they ever had. Like, they get their dream house or dream car or like, you know, start traveling more than they ever did, you know, and they're spending more money, you know, they retire now. But there might, you know, like, or they, you know, after that person passed, you might need more money because maybe they didn't like to travel, but you always promised yourself that when they die, I'm going to travel. I'm just joking. That's terrible. But you never know. Well, you're going to need some money, you know, to replace them, because if you're not spending, because they didn't let you spend a lot, you got to keep yourself under control, or you got to have a way to replace that income. And the earlier in life you figure that out, the better. You know, trying to figure that out at 60 and seeing how much like a life insurance policy would cost, that's expensive, you know? So you want to, you know, if you're saying, well, you know, we want to have, you know, some permanent coverage so that at any point, anything ever happened to you, even if you're 80, I want to have your income replaced, you know, by this policy. The earlier, the better in the purchase. Because it's just going to be less expensive, you know? And there's like, you know, things that are going to affect how much you have to pay for life insurance are indeed the smoking. There's even companies that will cover marijuana smokers in states that it's legal on life insurance policies because they're excited about the opportunity to charge you more. Mm-hmm. Soon as it went legal, I started getting emails and stuff saying, we cover people who smoke weed. They probably said cannabis, whatever, but I was like shocked. You know, it was like, so, and they just sent it to everybody licensed in Virginia, I guess. But like, you know, but also your credit, your driving record, like people who have a DUI are expected to die before people who never got a DUI. Do y'all think that's true?
No.
I don't know. You have to play it out. Like, you have to play it out. From what I've seen, it's true. Like, the people that I've known that have had DUIs, even if they don't die from being drunk, they've died prematurely.
It's because their judgment is impaired.
Exactly. Like, just as a person, that's the way their actuaries have figured it out. But I'm telling you, it takes a certain type of person to go on the road drunk.
And that may hold true in certain families, but over on my dad's side, no.
Then they won't get caught. Then they won't get caught. But if it is the person who gets caught, you can just sit down and write down when they die, some of them, you were going to realize that it was before their time. They're not thinking of this stuff off, not this is what is happening.
Right, remember, they're going by numbers, statistics.
I know, but they evidently, they've carved out, you know, the Davis side of the family, because
No. I'm telling you, in denial, that's all. They died.
They're up to 90 years old and still kicking, and still the last one, first one up in the morning, the last one in the bed at night. And
they never had a driver's license. That one don't count.
My Uncle Herman, think he was.
And he had to get a DUI. Like, see, living in the country, in the country, it don't count. Because I'm telling you, my cousin did die prematurely, but he never got a DUI. Because you can drive up and down the road, you know that, in the country. Like, without a DUI. Like, so, but he ain't had no life insurance either, so. But, you know, did your people have life insurance?
They had life insurance. My Uncle Herman, he lived to be like 95. He lived in Pittsburgh.
But by the time he died, like literally, seriously, was he really financially astute and a person who would drive drunk?
Oh, hell yeah. All right, everybody.
Exactly. He died with a mansion too, right? And a beautiful wife.
A mansion,
he had a mansion and a beautiful wife. Let's fill the story all the way out.
Wait, hold up.
There's someone out there that you are messing them up statistically. Just the fact that you are putting this shit out in the atmosphere, there's somebody who you fucking up right now. Excuse my language, but you are. You don't even need to say that. I could have saved some people's lives. You know how many people are mad because I said statistically, DUI, you're going to die early, da-da-da. People will change their habits over that. Here you go. Oh, my uncle, he lived in 97. He was drunk.
That's true.
Whatever. I'm going to ask other family members that live closer to him. And they will tell you.
Wait a minute, somebody.
That he was wise enough to get in the car with other people. He did not ever drive drunk. That's the way I'm seeing this man. That lives.
There are people on this line, JB. I'm telling you, they've got folks in their family just like me.
So. Yes, but they'll sit and not drive drunk. The ones that are gonna live to 97 are gonna make good choices. That's right. That, you know, they join. I'll have to play this back. Oh, just joy the, you know, you don't even need to, because she just messed the whole day up. See, Miss Brand, I think she's answering to the fact where you said everybody's got somebody out there, Zach. But I'm gonna tell you. I could go with the statistics, you know, I don't even have a family member that's lived to 97. Like, you know, so I couldn't even say that. But every family member that I had that was an alcoholic, they definitely died prematurely. So I know that I come from a family that does not do well with drinking. And I thank God that I never started doing it, because it doesn't work well with our DNA. But you're right. There are some people that, you know, they can drink people out the bar. I mean, it's sad. Thank you, Ms. Branson. I'm glad somebody does. Exactly. It's just not, you know, but those are the type, in thinking about like the things that will make it cost more, they go into your DMV record and they look at those things. Like the correlations that these scientists have done with credit and driving under the influence or being under the influence, that I've even seen them turn down people who applied with another company years ago, but they had drugs in their system years ago, and they turned them down for that. Isn't that something? I also had someone who applied. I never knew they had a drug problem. Applied for life insurance. I never in a million years would you ever think that that person had a drug problem. And years later, it came out. It was very, very, very hard on them. You know what I'm saying? Like but God gave them that warning that this problem is stopping you from being able to get this insurance. That was God. Like, and you know, sometimes you have to wonder, like, how many warnings do people get before, you know, just everything just blows up in their face? You know, when we get the warnings, let's take heed. And let's take heed, you know. And then that was my thing. I felt that I was just getting too many questions about, like, you know, using life insurance and then putting a trust as the beneficiary, and then the trust would hold all the money, and then everybody in the family could take loans, you know, from the trust. You know, that is, you know, and that's where the basis of the book, Be Your Own Bank, came from. Now, and so the family members would just, when they died, they just would put the money in the trust, and it would not go to paying bills and things like that, which typically we have to use life insurance for. And that's what we have to realize, is if you buy into this concept, who is going to suffer because you're sitting this money over here and nobody has access to it except for if you want to take out a loan for it? How long you think that's going to last? You know, most people who buy life insurance need the life insurance to cover that particular need. Now, you come from, you know, a family who, you know, can set up a separate entity and pay for those legal documents on the trust and then put the trust as a beneficiary because nobody else needs the money right now, you know, to eat, then that's cool. You know, that's cool. Okay, we should, you know, it's not an argument that could be made against not spending money and saving the money. The whole problem would come in on just who's going to be in charge. What if so-and-so dies? Who takes over then? Who do you decide who can get the loans? How do they get the loans? How does the interest get paid back? What if they don't pay you back? Are you prepared to sue a family member? You know, those type of things have nothing to do with life insurance. But that's the real deal of how those things happen. Remember when investment clubs were really, really popular, you know? So what I have found to be true also is that the more people you get involved, the more complicated it is going to be. And are you ready, you know, to be able to say no, you know, in those type of situations, if people buy into that, you know, who's going to, first of all, pay for the legal documents to set it up? Who's going to be in charge? And who's going to pay for, you know, all these life insurance premiums that are going to be paid, and the beneficiary is this other entity, you know, that you created? No. So with everything that is presented to us that comes in between you and your money, you got to, you know, ask yourself, first of all, what do I need? It goes all the way back to, what do I need life insurance for? You know, and the life insurance is to take care of and to protect the family from an unexpected need at its basic source. At the basic need for it is just to replace that bill payer, replace the income that is lost because of that person's death. No? So, like, all of the other things where you get into, where these things sound like really exciting, and, you know, and they tell us, like, always, it seems like they, you know, all of these little videos do a good job of impressing us, as long as it makes it look like this is something that white people do and y'all Negroes don't know nothing about it. So you're being left out. But all of us, you know, do this. And if most of those things, like, If you walked around and asked 10 white people, you know, they're going to say, like, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what you're talking about. But they're always telling us, like, you know, oh, this is what white people do, you know. This is what white people do, as if they don't live in the same world with us. No, white people are in the same struggle that we're in. And in our attempt, you know, to like do what they're doing, you know, an intelligent white person is trying to figure out how to avoid stuff like that too. They don't want to be robbed. They don't want to be taken advantage of either. No, but, and I've helped many of my white friends because of them being exploited from their own people. But we have this thing about, we think, oh, this is exclusive to us. Like, black folk just don't do right by black folk and this and that. You know what I mean? It's not true. You know? But one thing that I believe that could really empower us is to just get more information on things before we buy in to doing just because everybody in this little room that you're in is doing it. And you feel, have this fear of missing out. So I've got to do that because like everybody else there, they look really successful and they flash a couple of gold watches and some rings and, you know, stuff in front of you. You know, real money is not going to do that. I'm going to tell you, people with money are going out of their way to stay low key. But we've just been told, like, you know, rich people do this, rich people do that, rich people do this, you know. And rich people are you. You are the rich person as soon as you decide to be. They're not absolutely no different from you, except for they make more good choices and they don't rape. They're just not trying to hunt down. Like some, you know, greed. It's not greed based. You know, and when I say rich, I mean people that are truly wealthy. Yeah. And they're not, the more money schemes that you can avoid and just focus on real information, you know, like, okay, I'm looking at that. Okay. Let me check on some other things. Or, you know, let me decide, you know, I think that we, you know, should really, our community really needs to consider, you know, talking to registered investment advisors like myself that are willing to talk to you no matter what level of wealth that you have. Because we have to approach things differently. We look at everything holistically. You know, so I think that most people are just oversold. They just always feel like you have to buy something all the time, you know? And I just thank God for allowing me to just be able to share information and not have to stress you about you got to pay me this, you got to give me this, you know? I just thank God. I'm not judging those who really need it. You know what I'm saying? That And I can't tell you how many times people tell me that I'm doing the wrong thing. From the minute I started my business and I was doing workshops, these same things, but I would just do them out in public, you know. Now we have this opportunity. Some of you are all over the world. We have Afroeconomics members everywhere. I'm going to Los Angeles next week. And I was talking to Ms. Wilson and she said, oh my God, JP, you're going to be right here. You cannot be right here without me. You know what I'm saying? Like, the knowledge is there. We just have to like reach out, you know, and touch each other and trust yourself. And when you feel, when it doesn't feel right, stop doing it anyway. Don't do it. If it doesn't feel right, don't do it. I got to find out more about this. Find out more. That's right. That's right. It's there. That's right. Amen. But, you know, find out more. No. But, and I put on my Facebook wall the other day, finally, I heard someone say that I have found out, it was a brother too, he said that the older I get, and he was like in his 20s, looked like, he said, the older I get, I realize that the things that really matter are free. You know, and I said, I was reading something the other day, and it said, do not try to, it said, you cannot make a man happy by giving him, and it wasn't talking about like a woman making a man happy. It was talking about man. Like, so let me say it and like, think of it in biblical terms, like, but this is not out of the Bible, but it said, like, let's say it like this. Do not seek to make man happy by providing more riches, but make man happy by reducing his desires. And I said, oh my God, well, how can you do that? Like, you know, everybody wants everything. But, you know, when I looked into it, when I just thought about it, and it took days, and I thought about it, and then, you know, and I said, like, what it is it's saying, provide so much that your mind doesn't have to be, like, you are complete. That is my desire for Afroeconomics members. They don't have to feel like they got to go all the way around, you know what I mean? Everywhere. Like, you know what I mean? So I thank God, like, hopefully that our holistic approach allows them to reduce their desire for listening. You know what I'm saying? They don't even, you know, they don't have to worry about going in, you know, instead of different things, they say, come to this meet. You know what I'm saying? They don't have to worry about that, you know, because their desire has been reduced. They don't chase money anymore because they know that they're going to be wealthy. And that is reducing the desire to go out there and be greedy, you know what I mean? And hungry, you know, it's to keep you. But instead of being hungry for worldly stuff, be, you know, hungry for more wisdom, more of taking care of what I have. No, like a lot of times, like somebody could come in, like, you know, the plumber came in today and the plumber said, you know, we're doing a special and the toilet was just broken. It just needed whatever toilets need, right? He said, we're having some glamorous name, like a president's special. And because of customers like you, because you've called us before, you're a special customer. And because you're a special customer, you can get a brand new, I'm talking really nice toilet. You can replace that whole thing. You can put that. I was like, boy, he is good. Like, you know what I mean? He's like, me myself, because I need a lot of plumbing. And he's like, told me I could get, like he said, instead of like $1,200, you could get a whole new toilet for like $600. And I was like, he said, or I can fix it. I can fix it for $200. I said, yeah, let's fix it for $200. Which is probably already too much. You know what I'm saying? I was like, nobody even uses that toilet down there. I don't understand how it got broken. He said, well, that's the problem. See, either way, they're going to win. You're going to have a problem if people use it too much, or you're going to have a problem because nobody uses that toilet. He said, you got to use the toilet. You just got to use it. Like the toilet, like, you know, something about the plastic or whatever. I was like, oh, okay, yeah, I'm going to use that toilet all the time now. I better go down there. I haven't even checked to make sure it works. Because I never go down there, like, you know.
But you know the story of Solomon, when he became king, he asked for wisdom, the wisdom to rule with great judgment and humanity. And God told him, because you asked for wisdom and not riches, I will give you riches.
Amen. What a good one. What a good analogy to what I was saying. Yes. Yes. He's like, I got enough. I got enough. Just give me, you know, he's like, Lord, yes, you got, it took great wisdom to appreciate it. Amen. That is so good. Yes. I remember that. No, I remember that. That is so true. I mean, we don't know how valuable, you know, wisdom is, you know, and the self-esteem to question things. Now, I remember being in high school and I had this trig teacher and I would ask her questions and she said, well, you're nothing like your sister. Your sister didn't ask questions like that all the time. You know, she's a sister. And I said, yeah, you're right. I am nothing like my sister. You know? And then as God would have it, I went to speak I had a speaking event and I was like pointing out like different teachers that I had that were in the room and I didn't choose her. And she said, so she comes up and she says, you know, I taught you trig. And I said, yes, ma'am. And you remember me? And I said, yes, ma'am. I started to say, but if my sister was speaking, she would have introduced you. But I remember you telling me I asked too many questions. I mean, she was so irritated. I'd be like, and then like, you know, and then to go so low as to bring my sister up in it. Like, you know what I'm saying? She's like, I know I'll get her with this one. Let me compare her. Just as I was like, yeah, I'm like, that's nothing new. I get compared to her every day. You just like everybody else. That's all you did was put yourself, you know, in that category. But that was funny. I was like, yeah, I remember. Then that's funny, but you just remember what did Maya Angelou said? You remember how people made you feel. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, there is not a problem. And that's why our community ends up, and especially women, like, feel like it's a big deal to ask a question. So when they ask a question, they act like it's going to get a fight, you know? I just wondering, what about blah, blah, blah? Like, you know what I'm saying? It's like, it's no big deal, sis. It's no big deal. You can ask whatever you want. It's your money. It's your toilet. It's your stuff. But because of the beat down on each other, stuff like that, like, you know, like, don't ask, you know, you learn that, you know, as some kids would have never asked another question because they see it as, you know, that there's something wrong with that shoe. I got that at UVA too. And I'd have to be the one asking the questions. And then afterwards, the students would say, Lord, I'm so glad you asked that question, but I had to get the beat down from the teacher. You know what I mean? Woe is the teacher who is bothered by your student being interested. They're like, me being mad because we'd have said, can I get $10 million worth of insurance on myself? Shoot, she know I'm going to call her tomorrow. When you want to apply for that, I'm sure. I mean, it ain't got to be 10 million. I heard your interest. No, wouldn't it be funny though? I'll check. You sound really interested last night in getting $10 worth of insurance. I don't even, Lord, that would set everything straight. I could, you know, exactly.
It'd be just like the toilet.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. $10 million. I need to find it, see if I find me a company that will help. Like, we're gonna find that. The question is, are you willing to pay? It would probably be about $200,000 a year. No, you can pay if you can pay that. As long as you know what I'm saying, we can do it. But I had this agent that was doing that with a client. He had him taking out like $100,000 a year, promising him that he would be able to get tax-free income of this guaranteed amount at a certain age. And I showed the client, I was like, I see he wrote this here, but that's not going to happen according to this policy. it says like your guaranteed amount is this. And then, so what he's saying could possibly happen, but it's not guaranteed to happen. And you can't get it back. But look, but I'm just like, but I'm glad to meet you, because with 10 grand a month, and you are paying it? Exactly. That's a blessing. Just for life insurance. Isn't that something? But you should have saw the guarantees that he had, though, that he was saying he was going to do. That's just terrible. So, like, be very careful, you all, in the and you know, ask around. And I don't know, you know, anyone's current situation, but you know, if you have any life insurance questions, I would prefer that you call me, because I get too many emails. So I would prefer you go old school and just leave a message even tonight, 844-522-7926. And, you know, try to communicate the question as much as you can. And if any of you call and I don't get to call you right back, please call again. We have to remember that what I want to give you is a complimentary consultation. So help me help you. If you want free help, help me help you by calling me back. You know, because believe you me, somebody is calling and calling and calling and making sure that they get that free help. I got clients, you know what I'm saying, all day long. So the one that's going to get the free help is the one that keeps calling. You know, Mr. Green said, I read yesterday, rich people stay rich because they act poor. Poor people stay poor because they act rich. That's strong right there. Not the truth. Yeah. And the it is sad, you know, because we haven't been. We have really been socialized to act. Like, I did this podcast about why I don't think that we should fake it till we make it. No, it is truth, Ms. Branch. Mr. Green, Ms. Branch said that is true. It's true. Like, you know, we should not fake anything. No, let's do our best with what we have. That's not faking it. Doing the best with what you have, not carrying your troubles on your shoulder, that's not faking. That's faith. That is faith. You know, the reason that, I'm able to persevere is because I feel that it's my responsibility to be strong for you. You know, it gets to the point where I don't like to hear people complain. So I know you don't need to hear me complain, you know? So we don't need to complain when there's answers out here for us and there's people that actually care about us. You know I care about you. I want the best for you. I've committed my career to us and I'm not stopping. I'm giving my life to our empowerment. You know, Ms. Williams, that's right. Another PHS graduate right there, Tracy Green said that. You know, exactly. I wonder if Mr. Green remembers you teaching. Miss Williams was a teacher. And she looks like a 20-year-old right now. And she is well into her 30s. Amazing. And the, you know, but that's from being a nice teacher. Wouldn't it be funny if she was my trig teacher? I'm just joking, but that would be funny too. They'd be like, I don't even remember telling you not to ask questions, but I just don't understand why you didn't point me out. Because You told me I asked too many questions. That is so sad. That is sad. Like, but we need to be careful. Don't tell these young people that, you know, they're very impressionable. Love our young people so that they will be motivated and not hold it against you when you're older. Exactly. Like with the I remember like when I started my business and people would always tell me like, oh, it's not gonna work or this isn't gonna work or this and that. So like I've told y'all before, whenever anybody comes up to me and they have an idea, I have to keep their idea alive because I know that that's what Afroeconomics must have sounded like to these people. And especially when I said, oh, I'm an Afroeconomist, and they were like, are you out of your mind? And I'm like, yeah, I'm going with it. I'm going with it. I hope so, Rosita. I really do. I really do. I know you out there shopping. That's why you said tonight's show. Shoot, because you out there shopping. You probably at the mall right now. But the, so let's make sure that you realize that everybody doesn't have to have life insurance, but you do have to have a way to protect your family. So when you are young, especially when you're young and your family is young, insurance, life insurance can be a cost-effective way to protect your family, but you have to do it correctly. You know, so if you companies will say do term. And if you do term, you still can end up being robbed because every year you're doing a 1-year term with that company. So they're making more money off you every year. So what you have to do is just be aware of how better it would be for you to do a longer term. You want to make sure your house gets paid off. You want to get make sure the kids are out of the house. You want to make sure, term can be extremely affordable to get a large amount of insurance to cover a particular time of your life. That doesn't mean you have to have it your entire life. And even if you get a permanent policy, I have to make you aware. I want to. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to show you how it changes over time. And if you do this, then this is going to happen. And it's all in your original packet. But most people just don't look at it. They want to look at the abbreviated one that they made extra and checked off that they didn't give you. So be careful with excess stuff that, wasn't supposed to be given to you in reference to a product. If it's from it's a particular insurance company, you focus on the information from that insurance company that we ran the quote from. But they ran it from. I saw something on TV and it, on online, and it said like the best insurance companies or something. And all they did was list the ones that sponsor and the ones that are doing money and spending money with them. You have to be very careful with how you decided what they didn't even determine the criteria based on, their rating or their payment ability or, anything. And there are a lot of companies out there that have a history of discriminating against our community. We have options now. You have insurance companies that still exist today that were insurance slave ships. Why you got to have your policy with them? You got insurance companies that you got your life insurance policies with that didn't even want to insure homes in Black neighborhoods. And we're doing it. It's just, it doesn't matter. Yes, it does. And then the government encourages them to spend money marketing to us so that they can make more money off us instead of figuring out a way how they can apologize to the community that they blackballed. Mm. So definitely, continue to ask more questions. I'm here for you. Any questions before y'all go? Y'all good? Y'all good? Yo, I'm sorry. It's almost 10. What is wrong with y'all? How somebody talk about life insurance for 2 hours? Now, y'all know we in geek mode. Only a geek can talk about life insurance for 2 hours.
But it's been very informative. Thank you.
That's so positive. You're the best. Y'all are the best. Yeah, and I think it's some, you know, we don't really talk about it a lot, so, you know, that's good. I don't know what happened to Mr. Dr. Jones, right? He decided he ain't gonna...
He's probably in Africa.
That's probably what it is. He didn't want to talk about life insurance, but the key there is that, you know, life. You know, but it's really about death, isn't it? And life insurance on you is not for you.
Right.
How about that? Lone Wolf, look at him. Thank you. Thank you, Miss Person. So sweet. LaWanda, you and Miss Davis were good today. LaWanda and Weedo.
That's my buddy.
Exactly. Lone Wolf Firearms Training.
Is Miss Persons, is she from Georgia?
Yes. Might as well be. She from the country, Virginia.
Who is she?
She said, I ain't from Georgia, girl. You know I ain't from Georgia. No. She might, okay. But she probably got some family there, though.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Ms. Williams. That's a blessing.
Would you call me when we get off the line right quick, please?
Probably not. I got lots to do. I got lots to do tonight.
It will only take 5 minutes.
Of course.
Or maybe less.
I look forward to it.
I'm just trying to settle up on that $10 million policy.
I know that's right. I forgot. How I forget that quick? Yeah, you know I got to call you. We're going to start on that e-app right now. Y'all have a great night.
Good night, all.
Good night. God bless y'all.
Love you.
That's right, Miss Persons.
I'm not saying that. I'm trying.
Miss Persons, you need to come on Friday mornings. That's what you need to do.
That number, you can't text the but you definitely call and leave the message, and then I'll Casey, then we can get just be sure to call, but nah, it's not a text. It's an actual landline. Good question. Take care.
Give me
my HOA.
Right, click here.
All right. I got you. Bye bye. Thank you. Good night, everybody. Good night, Joe Jones. That's right. I'm so glad that you hung out.
You don't need no
we'll have to talk about this again. I hope it helps.
Only you feel my
God bless you.
Body. Only you feel my
Thank
body.
You.